Hey, story fans, it's your old pal, the Writing Ref. I don't hate, I just officiate your favorite video games. I apologize for the lack of content for a couple weeks, but I've been totally absorbed in my writing and the game Jedi Survivor. That's what we're going to talk about today. Here are some still shots of my experience. I really love the gameplay, the customization, and especially the story. This video game sequel achieves something rare, where it felt like your main character had not lost all of his development from the previous game. He has all the skills you already learned, and this game lets him learn more. The story also went into unexpected directions, and has tie-ins to almost every era of Star Wars. But I did have a penalty to call in the game, and it has everything to do with the development of the villains. So let's have the call, and then I will get to explaining. Penalty on Jedi Survivor.
The villains of the game
do not pass the "would they really?" test. Result of the play is a lack of emotional investment in the boss fight.
Somehow Palpatine returned.
Rebellion told me to protect them. What if they get sick?
While Danny kind of forgot about the Iron Fleet and Euron's forces.
Before we get into the penalty on the villains, let's review the story of Jedi Survivor. So, with that being said, if you haven't finished the game or still are avoiding spoilers for Jedi Survivor, leave now, but do leave a like and then come back later. Jedi Survivor picks up sometime after the events of Jedi Fallen Order, and Cal has pushed away the rest of his original found family in order to fight the Empire on his own terms. He teams up with Saw Gerrera and forms a sort of new family, and then promptly gets them all killed. Normally this would be a penalty in itself, but I do make some allowances for this being a video game.
Yes, very sad. Anyway, it got me thinking.
And that got me thinking. The idea of losing one family and reconnecting with your old one is good, because now he's experienced loss, and he doesn't want to lose his original, more important family, who are also, by the way, more important to us. So after an opening on Coruscant where everyone dies, he crash lands on a planet called Kobo, looking for his friend Grease, and encounters a High Republic Jedi in a Bacta tank, releases him, and finds out, of course, that he's a bad guy. And that is the first villain we are going to talk about. Dagon Gera. Or maybe it's Dagon Gera? I don't know. He's not that memorable to me, so his name is hard to get down correctly. Point being, he wasn't very memorable because he was kind of generic. Very anime villain, who they did their best to set up this relationship with his Jedi friend slash maybe romantic interest. And they really want to go to Tantalor, and they find Tantalor, and then some other bad guys find Tantalor too, and then the Jedi Council says, nope, we're leaving Tantalor for whoever, and abandoning it. And just because of that, or I guess maybe it's his last thought before he goes into the Bacta tank, that he stews in that thought for so long, for hundreds of years, that maybe he goes crazy. But as a motivation, it doesn't make much sense. It doesn't pass the would he really test. Would he really bleed his crystal red and go to war against the Jedi when the Jedi have already been wiped out? And all he has to do to kind of get to where he wants to go is pretend for a little while to be Cal's friend, if he's smart. But instead, no, he's just sort of like, you are, I am evil, and I know that you are part of the same Jedi that would want to have stopped me from going to Tantalor. Therefore, I am going to fight you every time I see you. Wahahaha. Now, you do get some pretty cool boss fights with him, but his motivation just doesn't make sense, because would he really? No, he would not. He would come out of that Bacta tank, realize the Jedi had been destroyed, and come up with, and if he really was still obsessed with it, like, find out if the Marauders or whoever took the planet over were even still there. He would go there himself. He would probably help Cal set up a whole new Jedi Order just so that he could have what he wanted in the first place. Cal and him want the same thing. A penalty on Dagon Gera for And he deserved to end up dead because he's stupid, even though his powers and fighting style were pretty cool. Dagon's right-hand man, Ravis, gets an honorable mention, if for nothing else than being the evil version of the Star Wars theme of the life debt. But he doesn't get a penalty for being a one-note villain, because sometimes you need those. Plus, he adds some Legends lore back into canon, with the likes of Dirge and their whole species. It's good to have the Gendai back in Star Wars. But you couldn't have another villain pretend to be Cal's friend and then betray him at the end, because he already had that going on with Bode. So, I guess Dagon got thrown to the wayside as the fake-out villain. And admit, I was surprised when Bode did his heel turn. Sometimes writers are afraid to fully develop a character because you're afraid to ruin that surprise. Never prioritize the surprise over character. One surprise that was handled really well was the relationship between Cal and Meryn. Their will-they-won't-they was very satisfying and led to one of the best action sequences of the game, where not only did I have a lot of fun, but I was very emotionally invested because I've been rooting for this couple to get together for a game and a half, and it's very well paced, great interaction, and this is just a fun and creative sequence that plays on the emotion of flying around, which is kind of what you feel like when you're falling in love, I think. Alright, enough dilly-dally. Let's talk about the game's main villain, that treacherous Bode Akuna. If you play through this game a second time, I think that you'd find a lot of what Bode does very foreboding. But seriously, well before he shoots our Jedi mentor and turns us all over to the Empire invader, there is plenty to go on that shows that whatever he's planning does not bode well for our heroes. Okay, I'm done now. Some of you more savvy Star Wars fans may know about Quinlan Vos. He's been in Legends and the Clone Wars, but his backstory is basically the same as Bode Akuna's, where he's a Jedi who was sent undercover because sometimes even the Jedi need espionage going on. So it makes sense there would be more than one Jedi who survived, like Quinlan. In fact, I even produced some AI art of Bode and Quinlan meeting together and exchanging some information. All this to say that Bode's backstory and his desire to defend his family are quite good. Only problem is, a lot of the story is skipped over or glossed over. A lot of important details, in fact, are only included after you've beaten the game and go around finding some force echoes that tell you that Bode was, in fact, friends with the Imperial commander of that base at one point. The most we get of his overall attachment to his daughter happens in this scene where he shows Cal basically, here's my cell phone picture of my daughter, like everyone does. This game is trying to pull the Star Wars version of The Last of Us. Now, in case you haven't seen The Last of Us, I'm going to keep this very generic. The main characters of The Last of Us are a father who's lost his daughter named Joel, and a girl who's immune to the zombie fungal virus named Ellie. By the end of the first part of The Last of Us story, Joel has formed an attachment to Ellie, sound familiar, and is forced to make an impossible choice. Seems obvious to me that this whole game was just to set up a scenario where you'd have to have Samurai and Cub and Cal and Kata for the third and final installment of Jedi series. They just are going with what they think is popular. And Cal's students are either getting handed off to Luke, or they're gonna bide their time meditating, I guess, until it's time to go train with Rey. But most importantly for this video, The Last of Us illustrates why I'm calling a penalty on Bode, where I would never call one on Joel. Before we get into the would he really test with Bode, some of the disconnect and the problem with him at the end of the game could have been solved by making him a point of view character. Probably right about here, where Seer dies as a result of Bode's actions. Now, could Star Wars pull off what The Last of Us 2 did and make us play a character that by now we hate and then start to see his point of view? I don't know. It's been done before, but it was very controversial. Now, because of that controversy, I don't think EA has the cojones to try to give you control of what is ultimately a villain for half the game. But it's neither here nor there, because what we're shown in this particular video game of Bode, even after his betrayal, makes his actions at the end of the game make no sense. They do not pass the would he really test. To their credit, the writers don't try to get us attached to Kata as much as they probably would have liked. So instead, they focus on a friendship between Cal and Bode. which you come to find out it was sort of real for Bode, but not really. I mean, he does save Cal's life at one point, which really adds to the drama, and especially since Cal ends up having to kill Bode with the gun he was gifted. That's pretty crazy to me. So there's a lot of tragedy and a lot of real emotion that the game is able to invoke in the player. But here, right here, Bode doesn't pass the would he really test. He's been defeated, he's got a lightsaber at his throat, and his daughter's standing there looking right at him. What does he choose? To keep fighting and force Cal to kill him. Bode does ask if he can guarantee Kata's safety in this place, and Cal doesn't answer. Now that's good writing, but just because no place is truly safe from the Empire, it doesn't mean Bode should give up all hope. Bode would not give up all hope because he's already completed most of his objectives. He's destroyed the portion of the Empire that knew about him and his family, and got Cal to help him do it. Conceivably, he also destroyed the Inquisitor that killed his wife. And all that fighting, the key ingredient is that Bode never realizes that destroying the Empire is the way to ultimately keep his daughter safe, or fighting the Empire. Put all that aside, the silence between Bode and Cal, right before Bode struggles to the end, is indicative that Bode knows that even this place is not safe from the Empire, not because Cal is planning to build a Jedi Academy there, but because it just isn't any guarantee at all, no matter what. And if that's the case, then Bode just looks out of his mind. He doesn't look like he's gone to the dark side. Now, we can identify with madness, but in order to do so, we would have had to make Bode a point of view character, Last of Us 2 style, and this should never happen. But it happens because we want to set up a samurai and cub for Jedi, whatever it's called, part 3. And for that, I've got to call the penalty. And there you have it, story fans. Jedi Survivor, a great game with villains that could have used a little better story development, which, who knows how hard it is to do rewrites on a video game. I'll let the video game experts talk about the problems with the release and all the PC-related crashes and things like that. But if you like this video, make sure you subscribe to get more content on video games, books, movies, and your favorite TV shows, where I officiate and call penalties to make them better. Give us a like, and if you have any disputes on what I've called in the comments, let me know, and I'll throw the red flag and review the video. We'll see you next time. This has been The Writing Room.